In today's video, we're going to be doing an in-depth review on the Colorado 4-Pass Loop. This review is going to be similar to the one that I did on the road coming from Crested, Butte to get to the actual trailhead. So if you haven't seen that one, I will definitely link that one at the end of the video. In this video, we're going to be going in depth on the length of the trail, the difficulty, navigation, campsites, water sources, and I'm going to share a lot of my pictures and videos to try to help everybody out as much as possible. We're also going to be covering permits, as well as the best times to take this trail. So this trail has 4 mountain passes, which are Frigid Air, Trail Rider, Buckskin, and West Maroon. So your minimum elevation on the trail is going to be around 10,000 feet, and then your maximum elevation is going to be around 12,500 feet. For me, this trail was 30 miles, so it was 2 miles to the actual trail, and then the actual trail is 26 miles, and then after that, on my way back out, it was another 2 miles, which came up to 30 miles. So the times that I would recommend hiking this trail, the earliest I would probably say is mid-June, but for me, I would probably be safe and I would say maybe early July would be a good time to go. I wanted to go when everything was green during the springtime, which is early July into mid-July. And so I went right at the end of July. The latest I would probably recommend is during the month of September. After that, I probably wouldn't recommend going on this trail just because the snow out there can get really, really deep. So definitely keep that in mind as well. So the trail difficulty, I'd seen some videos where people weren't able to make it. And I know that everybody's experience is different. For me, I didn't find that it was that hard. There were definitely moments that were very trying for sure, but I met a couple on this trail and they were in their 70s and they were hiking this trail going around this way and then they were going back around the other way again and back out. So they were hiking this trail twice. So if a couple in their 70s can do it, I know definitely other people can do it as well. Also, there was a father and his son. His son could not have been any more than probably, I'd say 10 years old. And they were out there hiking it. I came across them when I was at my camp spot in this area. So definitely keep that in mind. It's definitely worth trying. I wouldn't say it's a super hard trail, but I would say it's probably an intermediate trail. There are some people that can do this whole trail in a day. For me, I know my body will not allow me to do that. And plus, I definitely want to enjoy the views. So navigation on this trail is really easy. So I had a map, I had a compass, and I had a GPS. I did not touch my map or compass, not one time. And my GPS, I probably only pulled out once or twice. It's a very defined trail all the way throughout. So there's no spots where you have to kind of figure out where you're going. So that was extremely comforting for me, knowing that the trail was going to be laid out just fine. All right, so let's get started. So I started the West Maroon trailhead right here. The reason I started here is because the parking is free and you can park there when you want, and also you can leave when you want. Or you can also start here at the Aspen route, which will connect you right here. So for this route, you do either have to reserve parking or you have to take a shuttle bus up to the trailhead. For me, I didn't want to go that route because I didn't want to spend the money on that. Also, on top of that, I didn't want to be locked down just in case I needed to stay out an extra day, which I did. So when you first get to the trailhead, whether you're starting at the West Maroon or the Aspen route, you're going to fill out a permit. Now, the permits are totally free as of the recording of this video. I've heard some talk about them changing that, but as of yet, nothing has changed. So you're going to fill out your permit. The information is basically asking how many people is on the trail, when you expect to leave, and things like that. So once you fill out that information, you're going to start your trail. So the hike from the West Maroon trailhead to the Aspen route is fairly smooth. It's just kind of uphill just a little bit. You're walking along the side of this mountain here. One thing I will point out is in this area right here, it might be a little confusing because there's a little trail sign that's kind of hidden in the grass right where these two split off. You're going to want to hang to the right to get to the actual trail. So there's a little sign there. It looks like it's pointing left, pointing to West Maroon, but you want to go right. So you're going to continue along on your way up. There are some campsites right across the stream here to your right. So there is a pretty nice camp spot over here, which I did wind up staying at my last day. So you'll continue on. I don't remember any campsites going through this area. So you'll continue on and you'll get to the actual 4-pass loop. Okay, so after you've made your way up through this area, it may look a little confusing because your pass is going to be on the left, but the trail is starting to go right. So the way it goes is it curves to the right and you're going to go up this mountain right here about halfway up. And then you're going to switch back over and go the opposite direction to get to your first pass if you're going clockwise. So you'll get up to your first pass. This first pass is pretty steep, but it's not anything dangerous. But once you get over that pass, you've got a great view in this whole area right here. And then another tip that I'll mention is take your time and take it slow. For me, I rushed. There was some people that I had met up with along this area here, and then we were kind of leapfrogging over each other and they got up to the actual pass before I did, and I decided I wanted to keep up with them. So as soon as I got done eating, they wound up heading back down, and I tried to keep up. And what happened was is I started feeling super sick because I had just eaten, and then I got up and started going immediately right after that. So take your time, because for me, I got elevation sickness, and I started feeling it once I got to about this area right here. So just take your time. From this point, you'll go down some switchbacks down the mountain, and then from here, it's a pretty big open field. Right about this area, you're gonna get into some trees. I don't remember any campsites from this point to this point at all. Now, from this area to this area, there's gonna be a bunch of campsites. So I personally did not stop through this section here just because some of them were on a hill or they were right off the trail and I wanted some privacy. There are quite a few good camp spots though, once you get from about this point to this area right here, which is where the waterfall is that's on the trail. So for me, the first day that I stopped right here in this area because it was right next to a waterfall, and also I had an awesome view of this whole valley right here. This whole area I could see. So it was a great area. There's plenty of water. I would definitely recommend stopping at that spot if you can. So then you'll continue on down. You'll go through some switchbacks, through some woods, through this area, because it goes downhill. And then you're gonna continue through a field. There are a few camp spots from this point to this point, which are in some really nice areas. I actually would have stayed there as well if I could have, but they were already taken. So another thing I would recommend when it comes to campsites is there are no designated camp spots. So I would recommend getting to a camp spot that you like early. So if you see something and it might be a little earlier on in the day, I would say it might be worth stopping and go ahead and get in that camp spot, because if not, somebody else could take it. And then you're just gonna have to probably settle for what you can get. So again, there are no reserved camp spots, but it's first come, first serve. So definitely keep that in mind. So you'll continue through here. So this area right here is gonna be your first water crossing. This water crossing wasn't very bad at all. It didn't come up above my knees. You'll just cross that area. After that, there are a few camp spots between here and here, which were pretty decent. Once you start going up the mountain, you're not gonna have any from here all the way up to here. So if you commit to going up to get to that top of that false pass, you're gonna have to go all the way because there's nowhere to stop. There might be one spot. I believe there might be one spot like right in here, just maybe. You're gonna continue along. It's pretty smooth sailing. All the way until you get to where this says North Fork right here. Once you get to that North Fork cutoff, it's gonna start going uphill from there. So what it's gonna do is there is a false pass, which is this right here, because it looks like you're getting to the top of your pass, but it's actually not. The top of your pass is actually right here. So you continue up. There is again another water source right here. This one I believe would probably be flowing around the year because there was a lot of water in that area. So once you make it up your false pass, this right here is going to be your next pass, which is Trail Rider. Now this area here is probably one of the most beautiful spots on the trail. I would definitely recommend camping here. There is a pond here which is going to have water in it, so you're going to have a good water source, and there are a few camp spots speckled throughout this area here. So you're going to continue up your pass. Once you make it to the top of your pass, you have a great view of SnowMass Lake. For me, I got caught in the rain going up this pass, which was not fun at all. It was freezing cold and I was sopping wet. So that day I made it up to the top, and I started making my way back down. There's a bunch of switchbacks on your way down. I stopped at the first place that I could, which was, I wouldn't say right here, which this tent spot right here is pretty accurate, because that's where I stopped that night. That was a decent camp spot, but I was just grateful to have somewhere to stop for that night because everything in my backpack was wet. So I stopped here that night. The next day, I got up pretty early and I started making my way down. There is a rock field probably from here to here, I want to say, which it's not too bad. It made me kind of nervous. I didn't know if rocks were going to be like kind of falling or whatever, but they're not. It's all pretty solid in that area. So you're going to make your way right across here and then you're going to make your way down to the trail. So you can take this route and go right and bypass the campsite area, but you won't be able to see SnowMass Lake. I highly doubt anybody would really want to take that way because that's one of the highlights of the trip, is seeing that and then the mountains right behind it. So I went right here. So this area is SnowMass Lake. So there was a bunch of camp spots in this area, but they were all on top of each other and there was zero privacy. I didn't like that, so for that reason, I didn't stop there that day. Plus, it was later on in the day and I knew I wouldn't be able to get a camp spot there, but you can still stop there if you decide to. It can get a little tricky finding your way out of this area. Only reason being is because there's a lot of different trails where people are walking, and it's just pretty, it's pretty open. It's under some trees, but it's pretty open, and there's no like designated trail. So this is one area where I did have to pull out my GPS. On this trail, I used Gaia Maps. I just pointed in the direction that I saw this trail going, which I knew I had to go, and then I just followed it and it got me there. So I made my way out. From here, you're gonna go down this mountain right here. I believe there was a few camp spots through this area as well. And then you're gonna get to an open field, and this right here is gonna be another one of your water crossings. This water crossing wasn't too bad. It was a little tricky to find my way across without taking my shoes off. But nevertheless, I still made it across there. So this spot is pretty nice. And then you're gonna start working your way up the hill going to Buckskin. So it's gonna start getting going uphill right as soon as you cross this water right here. Right after that, it's going to start going uphill. So it's pretty much a bunch of switchbacks all the way up. There are quite a few camp spots on the way up this mountain as well. So there's plenty of spots that you can stay if you need to. Also, once you get to about right here, it kind of levels out a little bit. And then there's some camp spots, I believe. I believe there might be one or two in this area here. And then you're going to continue your way up to Buckskin. Okay, so once you get to the top of Buckskin, you're gonna make your way back down through some switchbacks. It's pretty smooth sailing all the way down. I was kind of flying down this hill because there was another rainstorm coming, and I didn't want to get caught in that. So you're gonna make your way down here. There is another water source as well, which I believe is this one right here. This stream was flowing pretty good. My camp spot was right here. Also, there was another one in this area, I believe. The camp spot that was in this area was a pretty big one. It was just me and then a group of other guys that were there that night that had wound up coming a little bit later. So then you can make your way down. There's also some more camp spots going through some of these switchbacks in this area. Also, I believe there's some in this area as well. So now you're getting close to your Aspen route where you enter in. Or where you want to exit. So then you're going to continue going down the switchbacks through here. It's just making your way down the mountain through there. So you're going to make your way around. So real quick, one of the reasons why I did not go counterclockwise is because starting from here, I knew that I would only make it maybe about right here that first day. And I did not want to stop anywhere near where there would be a bunch of tourists and things like that. So I didn't want to stop in that area because sometimes people might come in, they might camp for a day, and then might head back out. And so I didn't want to be on top of people. So for that reason, that's why I went clockwise. But honestly, so in this area is pretty touristy. So there's going to be people all through here. And then also there are some camp spots in here, but when I was there in late July, they were closed so that the vegetation could grow back up in that area. So you're going to continue on. There is one spot where it gets a little tricky. So I believe it's right. Okay. So it's right here. So there's a little trail that looks like it's going off to the left, but it's not. The trail is going to be going to the right. And this, I believe, is where that open campsite was. You're going to go to your right, and that's going to take you back on the trail. So that's another little spot to look out for as well. But I mean, it's not going to take you off into the mountains anywhere. So you're going to continue on. It's going to go start going up a little bit. There are plenty of camp spots that I felt like were pretty secluded going through this whole area all the way up. So that's something to keep in mind as well. There's definitely plenty of places to camp. From here all the way through to, I'd say about like right here, you'll have plenty of spots, and it didn't seem like they were too crowded. So another thing to look out for is right in this area, you're going to cross this creek right here. It looks like the trail is gonna go straight, but there were some people that actually met up with me around this area that I was passing, and they were like, hey, when you get to this creek, make sure you go across it. So for me, I was going this direction, so the creek was on my left. So I knew I needed to cross the creek to go to the left. So definitely keep an eye out for that. Now, if you're coming this way, I don't think it's that confusing because I think it's pretty obvious that you have to go left because there's nowhere to go this way. But if you're not, then just definitely keep an eye out for that because there was a couple that actually wound up going this way all the way up this mountain. And I don't even think there was a trail over there, but I think they were just walking. So definitely keep an eye out for that as well, because you don't want to wind up going off the trail like they did. I was able to yell across the ridge to them and tell them that they had to go back. So definitely keep an eye out for that. you'll just cross that creek. So you continue your way up, and it's pretty smooth sailing all the way up through here. Once you get to about this point, you're just gonna start going uphill, and then I believe there might be one or two campsites in this area here. I believe there's a couple. So you'll continue your way up. For me, when I was on this trail, it started raining when I got to about this point. So it was raining my whole way up this pass again. So you will continue your way up to the West Maroon Pass. There was one spot on this trail that I would say was a little bit tricky. On this, going up this pass, it was a little switchback right at the end, right before we got to the top, and it was sopping wet outside and very slippery. So this one section looked a little bit sketchy, but I made it up there with no problem. So once you get to the top of this pass, you're gonna work your way back down again. Then you're gonna continue your way back down, and you're gonna meet back up again to that trailhead that goes to the West Maroon Trailhead on your way out. So then you're gonna continue your way out. On my way out, I stopped at this point right here, which there was a campsite over here. There was a few different spots where you could camp out right across this creek. So I stopped there the last day, and then the next morning I got up early and made my way back out to the trailhead. Another thing is, this was an extremely clean trail. I really did not see any trash on this trail at all. So the people who maintain the trail definitely do a good job of that. Also, the bathroom situation. So every trail has another little trail going off back behind it to where people use the bathroom. Just be courteous and make sure that you leave a rock wherever you use the bathroom at, so that people don't wind up digging up in the same place that you use the bathroom at. So when I went, there was definitely rocks placed everywhere where you could tell where people went to use the bathroom. So that's not a problem at all. As far as animals, I personally saw bear tracks that was kind of near a campsite, but I didn't see any bears. The only things I really saw were rodents, but my experience may vary from yours. So definitely keep some bear spray, but I wouldn't say that for me that was too much of a concern as far as bears on this trail. If you're interested in taking the West Maroon Trailhead, I did a video that covers this whole road going to Crested Butte that I will link at the end of the video, so definitely check that one out. If you guys have any questions, leave them down in the comment section below, and I will be more than happy to get back with you guys. Also, I did a part one and a part two of my experience out on the loop as well, so definitely go check that out. I will definitely be coming out with more videos, so keep an eye out for those, and thanks for watching.